One of the issues that comes up a lot in the film is about cultural identity. So it, not only is it music of the North being played by people who are not necessarily from the North, but also people living here, choosing to stay here, playing traditional Mexican music.
Pues nosotros vamos a conocer la música, sí, por eso la interpretamos. A la vez también, como pues se ve en la película, de ahí depende pues nuestra familia, de ahí sostenemos a la familia y pues nos ganamos el pan de cada día.
Palomo is a quiet one, but he's the mastermind behind the music. Palomo, had a quite a trajectory in Norteña music. He recorded almost 15 records with Los Palomos del Valle, right?
Sí, Los Palomos del Valle.
15 discos más o menos, ¿verdad?
Como 15 grabamos.
23 años estuvo en sí, el negocio de la música ahí en México.
Sí, pero pues ya se acabó, pues ya no había trabajo y pues se deshizo el grupo y pues se me ocurrió echar una vuelta por acá y por acá, pues.
The thing that sometimes what I wonder about the corridos and the songs, it's in thinking about what's happened in Mexico now, what's happening now really, with the violence and the really just terrible situation in some parts of the country. And I should say at the outset that my perspective on this is very much as one who looks at this as a problem similar to the problems with alcohol prohibition in America. You know, when we look at in the 1920s and Al Capone and the organized crime and the violence and the corruption and the jail cells and the murder and the glorification of the bootleggers and people dying and all this, that those were about people's desire for alcohol, but they were also about a prohibitionist approach to dealing with drugs that proved to be relatively ineffective in reducing the demand for alcohol, but remarkably effective in empowering organized crime and violence and corruption and all of these sorts of things. And so I look at what's going on in Mexico, and I think that this is very much the same thing. It's very much the same thing. I mean, you know, yeah, we're talking about substances apart from methamphetamine, but other substances that more or less, opium, coca, marijuana, they've been going for thousands and thousands of years. And in much of history in many places not actually been criminalized and been controlled through cultural traditions. And that when you see the what's happening now, where traffickers, gangsters are becoming the you know, challenging the state for sovereignty over places and engaging in levels of violence and investing their proceeds both in taking over other legal and illegal businesses, and in where the people who are drawn to those businesses are oftentimes, sometimes the people like you saw it in the documentary, people who just can't make it any other way, but sometimes also drawing people, the ones who are most inclined and comfortable with the use of violence, the ones who are most likely to be really brutal about this and who can take the young people you see here getting drawn in because the fishing business no longer works, but who are disposable people, as disposable or more disposable than you see anywhere else. Now, they are a manifestation of a failed government approach. And it's all well and good for Hillary Clinton to go down to Mexico and say, you know, I'm sorry, we have to do something about the demand for drugs in America. But what really needs to be happening is some discussion about changing the fundamental way we deal with this. A couple years ago, I was down in Culiacan, and there was a wonderful conference of 500 or 600 people at the university and the alternative newspaper. It was been Luis Astorga, the historian who was interviewed here at the very beginning, who actually grew up in Culiacan, I think teaches at the Colegio de Mexico now, had helped organize and invite this. And I'm speaking on this subject before about 500 people, and I find out a few hours later that just a couple miles from where I was speaking, right near our hotel, there was a shootout. And you know, two police officers and three traffickers were killed. And over dinner that evening, I'm talking to one of the leading journalists, and I say, how do you write about this? And he says, well, we don't write 90% of what we know. And so, you know, to bring it back to the music piece, you know, there is this sort of schizophrenia, to use a colloquial sense of the term, in this. On the one hand, this sort of idolization of the traffickers, the heroes, the ones who are the rebels, the Robin Hoods. And you know, on the other hand, the casual reference to, oh yes, well, when my father was picked, you know, got arrested, you know, they told him they'd kill his two eldest children if he spoke. I mean, this is not just about killing you if you, you know, rat us out. It's about killing your children. It's a level of immorality that goes to another level. So I see this ambivalence around these, around the traffickers and in the music playing out that way. And I still, I'm actually really still trying to understand it, because I can understand that Amazon comes from, but.
Yeah.
Todos los corridos vienen de acá, ¿sí? Y a la vez, pues, sobre las fronteras, que pasan droga y todo eso, de ahí nacen corridos, ¿sí? Aunque, pues, viéndolo por ese lado, que, pues, eso de pasar droga entre nosotros no existe, ¿sí? Esa es la diferencia, de que nosotros somos músicos e interpretamos los corridos, pero nosotros no participamos en drogas, nada de eso.
I think most of you are bilingual, but for those who might not be, Ronnie's making a clear distinction that even though they might interpret corridos, they're not remotely involved with narco traffic or specifically the narco corridos, and that the northern music is played in all of Mexico, including in the south.
I think it will be a transformation. We are still experiencing that. We're not sure how it will end, but definitely I think that at a national level in the United States, this will affect the image of immigrants and the image of Mexican culture, definitely. But we still experience that change.
Podemos participamos en fiestas particulares. Sí, nos han contratado, nos llevan a tocar. No nomás dependemos del software. A veces nos llaman a restaurantes, ¿sí? Por ejemplo, en este día, 5 de mayo, nos han hablado a distintos restaurantes, entonces vamos a tocar. Y pues cuando hay fiestas, que algún aniversario, alguna boda, un bautizo, pues como repartimos tarjetas, pues nos llaman y también pues de ahí sacamos.
Y también te pregunto si ustedes componen música aquí sobre sus experiencias como...
Pues hasta ahorita no hemos compuesto, ¿verdad? Hasta ahorita no. Pero pues lo tenemos planeado entre los compañeros. Sí.
El Palomo he's a composer and he has some.
A ver, voy a decir sobre la música también. Lo que pasa es que yo apenas comencé con ellos. Yo tengo canciones compuestas también mías. Y como tenemos poquito tiempo, pues no ha habido tiempo de estudiar y de ponernos de acuerdo en el grupo, pues si vamos a seguir, pues algo de tiempo, ¿verdad? Porque muchos de nosotros, de los elementos, de varios compañeros, hacemos el grupo al momento y nos cuesta trabajo. Acoplarse y todo. Hay muchas cosas. Que el grupo es como el matrimonio. En verdad, así es el grupo. Y entonces, ¿qué pasa? Que a veces ya está el grupo hecho y con uno que salga o con algo que ya no le agrade al compañero, se descompuso el grupo. Entonces, pues ni ha habido pues tiempo de platicar entre nosotros.
They haven't really had time to discuss amongst themselves, and having a group is like having a marriage. Javier was also saying that they don't depend only on the subways, that they do play for parties or baptisms and cater to different events.
Pero me gustaría, si vamos a estar nosotros tres, pues me gustaría que pusiéramos mis canciones estudiando y eso para otra ocasión que estemos acá ya tocaremos mis canciones.
Well, the most likely way in which it enters right now, there's a gubernatorial election coming up this year, and the person who's leading the polls is Terry Goddard, who's the Attorney General of Arizona, whose father was a governor. I don't know what his position has been on the. Does anybody know? I don't know. But what was interesting about him, because he's a conservative law enforcement person, was in December of 2008, he spoke out publicly and he said that we need to have a debate on legalizing marijuana. which stunned people. And when he was asked why, he said, look, so far as we know, the Mexican drug gangs are making over 50% of their money from the marijuana business. I don't know if that's true or not, but that's the claim coming from the drug czar, the U.S. government. It may well be true. And he said the single best way to reduce the profits and power of the Mexican drug gangs would be to legalize it. And then he said, I'm not proposing we do it. Let's just have the debate. Now, what's also interesting is, and now you have in the United States, as I said, in California, there'll be a ballot initiative this election that would potentially legalize or allow localities to legalize marijuana. And I should say there's something interesting about the polling. A poll came out last week, and it showed that something like 56% of African Americans in California were in favor of legalizing, roughly 52% of whites, but only 45% or something of Latinos. And that part of that is explained, I guess, by cultural conservatism, et cetera. But the interesting thing that most people don't know is that if you ask the question, how and why was it that marijuana was criminalized in the United States, which happened in the early part of the last century, it had virtually nothing to do with the relative dangers of marijuana, which, as most of you know, are less dangerous than alcohol and many other drugs. It had everything to do with prejudice against Mexican migrants and Mexican Americans. The first marijuana prohibition laws were in El Paso, Texas, and Utah, and they were all about discrimination, stigma against Mexicans, Mexican Americans, that. And I sometimes wonder if a greater awareness of the historical origins of this law would actually have some impact on Hispanic-Latino opinion today in the United States, or for matter of Mexico.
I work in the community first, and I roll the health programs, and the people that migrate here is very healthy. They don't use drugs. They don't even smoke. So the people, the American people, see Mexican drugs. That's something that we don't want to reinforce. We want to that know that, okay, there's a situation. The people that came here is to work, is for that, for a need, not to be in the drug system. They came here from working and to bring money to the families. There's another reality, the people here, and they are the strong ones. And they are, the people that Mexico need to progress as a country, because they are here working. So the situation is a misunderstanding. So I hope that it's open and understand the people that we are here for work, not for dealing some people, but not for that. This generation is working, and the music is something universal. That's why we want to support that kind, that the music don't matter where you come. You have a contact with the culture, you know the people. So don't attack them. So that's something very important, like to enhance the Mexican culture. We have a history, so know us, know our culture, our songs, our food. So you don't kill me, and you accept me.
The principal producers in the world right now of marijuana and of methamphetamine is the United States. And we're one of the most economically developed countries. So you have pockets of poverty, you have people even who are not poor who would prefer this choice as well. So I don't think ultimately, when people look in Bolivia or Colombia or Afghanistan and say, let's provide economic development so that the farmers don't engage in this, I think the impact will be at best negligible. And that if it does succeed in a local area, it just shifts the growing to someplace else. So economic development for its own sake, but as a solution to the drug production and trafficking, I don't think that important.
Not really. Sonideros basically are DJs who reproduce recorded music. They can use norteño music sometimes, but they usually rely more on cumbia and other genres. But they use some norteño music, the more danceable kind of music. But the sonideros again are DJs that reproduce music, so it can be part of the tradition, but usually relies more on cumbia and more other kind of rhythms.
You're 26 years old, Mexican, but grew up in Chicago, mm-hmm. and struggled also with your own cultural identity and discrimination. And so she was asking, I believe, primarily Los Inmigrantes del Sur, what is their message to young people? So maybe we can start with that, and then we can.
No.
Just in the order in which the questions were asked.
Pues mire, el mensaje que les podemos dar es que pues estudien, si están aquí, ¿verdad? Que estudien, que le echen ganas, que salgan adelante, ¿sí? Porque si están aquí, vinieron por un propósito, ya que Dios les dio licencia de llegar aquí, pues el mensaje para todos es que estudien, que le echen ganas, que progresen, ¿sí? Que se preparen bien para que pues al menos salgan adelante y no estén como nosotros, pues aquí en la música.
The message is to study and to get ahead, and he said not to be like us, the musicians, pero con la música, es muy importante la música. Y bueno, estamos muy agradecidos por su presencia. One of the issues that comes up a lot in the film is about cultural identity. So not only is the music of the North being played by people who are not necessarily from the North, but also people living here, choosing to stay here, playing traditional Mexican music.
Pues nosotros vamos a conocer la música, sí, por eso la interpretamos. A la vez también, como pues se ve en la película, de ahí depende pues nuestra familia, de ahí sostenemos a la familia y pues nos ganamos el pan de cada día.
Palomo is a quiet one, but he's the mastermind behind the music. Palomo, had quite a trajectory in Norteña music. He recorded almost 15 records with Los Palomos del Valle, right?
Sí, Los Palomos del Valle.
15 discos, más o menos, ¿verdad?
Como 15 grabamos.
23 años estuvo en sí, el negocio de la música ahí en México.
Sí, pero pues ya se acabó Pues ya no había trabajo y pues se deshizo el grupo y pues se me ocurrió echar una vuelta por acá y por acá. Pues.
The thing that sometimes what I wonder about the corridos and the songs, it's in thinking about what's happened in Mexico now, what's happening now really, with the violence and the just terrible situation in some parts of the country. And I should say at the outset that my perspective on this is very much as one who looks at this as a problem similar to the problems with alcohol prohibition in America. You know, when we look at in the 1920s and Al Capone and the organized crime and the violence and the corruption and the jail cells and the murder and the glorification of the bootleggers and people dying and all this, That those were about people's desire for alcohol, but they were also about a prohibitionist approach to dealing with drugs that proved to be relatively ineffective in reducing the demand for alcohol, but remarkably effective in empowering organized crime and violence and corruption and all of these sorts of things. And so I look at what's going on in Mexico, and I think that this is very much the same thing. It's very much the same thing. I mean, you know, yeah, we're talking about substances apart from methamphetamine, but other substances that more or less opium, coca, marijuana, they've been going for thousands and thousands of years. And much of history in many places not actually been criminalized and been controlled through cultural traditions. And that when you see the what's happening now, where traffickers, gangsters are becoming the you know, challenging the state for sovereignty over places and engaging in levels of violence and investing their proceeds both in taking over other legal and illegal businesses, and in where the people who are drawn to those businesses are oftentimes, sometimes the people like you saw in the documentary, people who just can't make it any other way, but sometimes also drawing people, the ones who are most inclined and comfortable with the use of violence, the ones who are most likely to be really brutal about this and who can take the young people you see here getting drawn in because the fishing business no longer works, but who are disposable people, as disposable or more disposable than you see anywhere else. Now, they are a manifestation of a failed government approach. And it's all well and good for Hillary Clinton to go down to Mexico and say, you know, I'm sorry, we have to do something about the demand for drugs in America. But what really needs to be happening is some discussion about changing the fundamental way we deal with this. A couple of years ago, I was down in Culiacan, and there was a wonderful conference of 500 or 600 people at the university and the alternative newspaper. It was Luis Astorga, the historian who was interviewed here at the very beginning, who actually grew up in Culiacán, I think teaches at Colegio de Mexico now, helped organize and invite this. And I'm speaking on this subject before about 500 people, and I find out a few hours later that just a couple miles from where I was speaking, right near our hotel, there was a shootout. And, you know, two police officers and three traffickers were killed. And over dinner that evening, I'm talking to one of the leading journalists, and I say, how do you write about this? And he says, well, we don't write 90% of what we know. And so, you know, to bring it back to the music piece, you know, there is this sort of schizophrenia, to use the colloquial sense of the term, in this. On the one hand, this sort of idolization of the traffickers, the heroes, the ones who are the rebels, the Robin Hoods. And, you know, on the other hand, the casual reference to, oh yes, well, when my father was picked, you know, got arrested, you know, they told him they'd kill his two eldest children if he spoke. I mean, this is not just about killing you if you, you know, rat us out. It's about killing your children. It's a level of immorality that goes to another level. So I see this ambivalence around the traffickers and in the music playing out that way. And I'm actually really still trying to understand it, because I can understand that amateur comes from, but.
Yeah.
Todos los corridos vienen de la palabra, ¿sí? Y a la vez, pues, sobre las fronteras, que pasan droga y todo eso, de ahí nacen corridos, ¿sí? Aunque, pues, viéndolo por ese lado, que, pues, eso de pasar droga entre nosotros no existe, ¿sí? Esa es la diferencia, de que nosotros somos músicos e interpretamos los corridos, pero nosotros no participamos en drogas, nada de eso.
I think most of you are bilingual, but for those who might not be, Ronnie's making a clear distinction that even though they might interpret corridos, they're not remotely involved with narco traffic, or specifically the narco corridos, and that the northern music is played in all of Mexico, including in the south.
I think it will be a transformation. We are still experiencing that. We're not sure how it will end, but definitely I think that at a national level in the United States, this will affect the image of immigrants and the image of Mexican culture, definitely. But we still experience that change.
Pues nos participamos en fiestas particulares, sí, nos han contratado, nos llevan a tocar, no nomás dependemos del software. A veces nos llaman a restaurantes, ¿sí? Por ejemplo, en este día, 5 de mayo, nos han hablado a distintos restaurantes, entonces vamos a tocar. Y pues cuando hay fiestas, que algún aniversario, alguna boda, un bautizo, pues como repartimos tarjetas, pues nos llaman y también pues de ahí sacamos.
Y también te pregunto si ustedes componen música aquí sobre sus experiencias como...
Pues hasta ahorita no hemos compuesto, ¿verdad? Hasta ahorita no. Pero pues lo tenemos planeado entre los compañeros.
Auto,
sí.
El Palomo he's a composer and he has some...
A ver, voy a decir sobre la música también. Lo que pasa es que yo apenas comencé con ellos. Yo tengo con canciones compuestas también. Mías. Y como tenemos poquito tiempo, pues no ha habido tiempo de estudiar y de ponernos de acuerdo en el grupo, pues si vamos a seguir pues algo de tiempo, ¿verdad? Porque muchos de nosotros, de los elementos, de varios compañeros, hacemos el grupo al momento y nos cuesta trabajo. Acoplarse y todo. Hay muchas cosas. Que el grupo es como el matrimonio. En verdad, así es el grupo. Y entonces, ¿qué pasa? Que a veces ya está el grupo hecho y con uno que salga o con algo que ya no le agrade al compañero, se descompuso el grupo. Entonces, pues ni ha habido...
They haven't really had time to discuss amongst themselves, and having a group is like having a marriage. Javier was also saying that they don't depend only on the subways, that they do play for parties or baptisms and cater to different events.
Pero me gustaría, si vamos a estar nosotros tres, pues me gustaría que pusiéramos mis canciones estudiando y eso, para otra ocasión que estemos acá, ya tocáramos mis canciones.
The most likely way in which it enters, right now there's a gubernatorial election coming up this year, and the person who's leading in the polls is Terry Goddard, who's the Attorney General of Arizona, whose father was a governor. I don't know what his position has been on the, does anybody know? I don't know. But what was interesting about him, because he's a conservative law enforcement person, was in December of 08, he spoke out publicly and he said that we need to have a debate on legalizing marijuana, which stunned people. And when he was asked why, he said, look, so far as we know, the Mexican drug gangs are making over 50% of their money from the marijuana business. I don't know if that's true or not, but that's the claim coming from the drug czar, the US government. It may well be true. And he said the single best way to reduce the profits and power of the Mexican drug gangs would be to legalize it. And then he said, I'm not proposing we do it, let's just have the debate. Now, what's also interesting is, and now you have in the United States, as I said, in California, there will be a ballot initiative this election that would potentially legalize or allow localities to legalize marijuana. And I should say there's something interesting about the polling. The poll came out last week and it shows that something like 56% of African Americans in California were in favor of legalizing, roughly 52% of whites, but only 45% or something of Latinos. And that part of that is explained, I guess, by cultural conservatism, et cetera. But the interesting thing that most people don't know is that if you ask the question, how and why was it that marijuana was criminalized in the United States, which happened in the early part of the last century, it had virtually nothing to do with the relative dangers of marijuana, which, as most of you know, are less dangerous than alcohol and many other drugs. It had everything to do with prejudice against Mexican migrants and Mexican Americans. The first marijuana prohibition laws were in El Paso, Texas, and Utah, and they were all about discrimination, stigma against Mexicans, Mexican Americans, that. And I sometimes wonder if a greater awareness of the historical origins of this law would actually have some impact on Hispanic Latino opinion today in the United States, or from other Mexico.
I work in the Comunidad Fuerte and I wrote the health programs, and the people that migrate here is very healthy. They don't use drugs. They don't even smoke. So the people, the American people, see Mexican drugs. That's something that we don't want to reinforce. We want to that know that, okay, there's a situation. The people that came here is to work, is for that, for a need, not to be in the drug system. They came here from working and to bring money to the families. There's another reality, the people here, and they are the strong ones. And they're, sorry, the people that Mexico need to progress as a country, because they are here and working. So the situation is a misunderstanding. So I hope that it's open and understand the people that we are here for work, not for dealing some people, but not for that. This generation is working, and the music is something universal. That's why we want to support that kind, that the music don't matter where you come, you have a contact with the culture, you know the people. So don't attack them. So that's something very important, like to enhance the Mexican culture. We have a history, so know us, know our culture, our songs, our food. So you don't kill me, and you accept me.
The principal producers in the world right now of marijuana and of methamphetamine is the United States. And we're one of the most economically developed countries. So you have pockets of poverty, you have people even who are not poor who would prefer this choice as well. So I don't think ultimately, when people look in Bolivia or Colombia or Afghanistan and say, let's provide economic development so that the farmers don't engage in this, I think the impact will be at best negligible. And that if it does succeed in a local area, it just shifts the growing to someplace else. So economic development for its own sake, but as a solution to the drug production and trafficking, I don't think that important.
Not really. Sonideros basically are DJs who reproduce recorded music they can use norteño music sometimes, but they usually rely more on cumbia and other genres. But they use some norteño music, more the more danceable kind of music. But the sonideros again are DJs that reproduce music, so it can be part of the tradition, but usually relies more on cumbia and more other kind of rhythms.
You're 26 years old, Mexican, but grew up in Chicago, and struggled also with your own cultural identity and discrimination. And so she was asking, I believe, primarily Los Inmigrantes del Sur, what is their message to young people? Maybe we can start with that, and then we can... Just in the order in which the questions were asked.
Pues, mire, el mensaje que les podemos dar es que, pues, estudien, si están aquí, ¿verdad? Que estudien, que le echen ganas, que salgan adelante, ¿sí? Porque si están aquí, vinieron por un propósito, ya que Dios les dio licencia de llegar aquí, pues el mensaje para todos es que estudien, que le echen ganas, que progresen, ¿sí? Que se preparen bien para que, pues, al menos salgan adelante y no estén como nosotros, pues, aquí en la música, ¿verdad?
The message is to study and to get ahead, and he said not to be like us, the musicians, pero con la música, es muy importante la música. Y bueno, estamos muy agradecidos por su presencia y participación en este evento.
Yeah, the basic point was that whatever happens with NAFTA has ultimately relatively little impact on the flow of drugs from Mexico through Mexico to the United States.
On that note, I know we've covered a range of issues, and it's one of many dialogues. I'd like to, first of all, have a big round of applause for all the speakers.
Yeah, the basic point was that whatever happens with NAFTA has ultimately relatively little impact on the flow of drugs from Mexico through Mexico to the United States.
On that note, I know we've covered a range of issues, and it's one of many dialogues. I'd like to, first of all, have a big round of applause for all the speakers.